Partnerships are vital to our global outreach, enabling us to take the love and hope of Jesus Christ to those who need it most. Our Boots on the Ground partnership program physically ministers to those in desperate situations all over the world. The Israel partnership furthers Kim's legacy of outreach to Israel and Jewish people worldwide. We invite you to become a partner today. Join us today and be part of a community that inspires hope, brings restoration to life, and often healing from the past. Together, we can make a difference, and we thank you for your ongoing support.
Shabbat Shalom and welcome to Israel Update. As you can see, Dubs and I are here together again. Dubs, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you. Thank you. Always a pleasure. And even though the subjects are heavy.
The subjects are heavy, but the company is good. And that's what it is. So what we're going to be talking about today is something that we can't get away from. And I know it's a heavy topic, but it's infinitely heavier for the Jewish people who are living in Israel, who are dealing with it every day. And that is Israel's looming war with Iran. Dubs, we've been texting up and down about this. Please just talk to the people about everything that you were saying to me on text, all the things you've been talking about that we've been talking about, because it's so important for everybody to know what's going on.
Well, just to put the things a little bit more in context and, of course, give a little bit more background, we know already that almost a year, it's 10 months that Israel has been entering into this terrible war with Gaza, the attack that came upon Israel from the Hamas, which wasn't in a void. Yeah, October 7th, wasn't in a vacuum, wasn't in a void space. No. It happens because of that constant encouragement by Iran for their proxies, which is Hezbollah and the Hamas and the Houthis and the militias in Iraq, just recently attacked American airbase, also in Syria and in the Iraqi-Syrian border. And the Americans are there just to watch over the situation that ISIS is not going to grow up again in that region. And all these proxies are heavily encouraged and pushed to attack Israel. So in that background and in that context, we are in the midst of a war, almost seven fronts, literally seven fronts, you can say, against Israel, almost just like the times of the War of Independence. And Iran is steering the entire situation. Iran is behind it all. Mm. And that's the reason that we are now sitting and speaking about this looming war that is happening, because the escalation is moderate, but it's persistent, and the situation is just the Muslim and the Iranian way is they have patience, and the world don't understand and don't see the huge danger that comes out of Islam, because for years and years and years it wasn't anything that they've done in one bang and that's it. They building up a little by little, they gain more surface and more land and more surface and more and more. And eventually you wake up and you are in a different total situation.
Yes.
That's the same story here. The Iranians has been building their power, building their proxies, encouraging them, equipping them, sending for years and years and years through the tunnels between Egypt and Gaza, weapons and advanced weapons and drones, sending weapons to the Hezbollah, which every day since October 7th, actually October 8th, they have been engaged in that war to the extent of dozens of thousands of Israelis that used to live in the Galilee, in the Golan, in the borders between Israel and Lebanon has been displaced and evacuated their homes, because their townships, their kibbutzim, their bases, everything has been hit and targeted and attacked by Hezbollah. And these issues are constantly continuing. The pressure within Israel over the government of Israel is growing at the same time, because it's impossible that dozens of thousands of Israelis, both in the south and in the north, lost their homes and lost their livelihood. The reason that I'm traveling right now and I'm not in Israel, which was supposed to be my most busy time ever.
Yes,
in my tourism business, that before October 7th, I was booked back to back until the end of 2025, and everything was canceled. That's the reason that there's no tourists coming into Israel. The economy is crippled. Businesses are closed. Factories that are usually, you know, the government wanted always to encourage the people to go to the periphery, and they gave all kinds of different grants and financial support to businesses to install themselves in the periphery. Now they cannot function, all these businesses, because of the fact that the enemies are targeting these areas. And in that pressure pot that Israel is in, the Iranians are poking and pushing and pushing more and more and more. They host the most archi-terrorists of the world. They do conferences with mega terrorists and all these organizations trying to plot how to attack Israel more. On April 13th or 14th, I can't remember exactly, 13th. They literally launched a huge attack over Israel that, thanks to an international coalition led by the United States of America, we were able to intercept most of their rockets and missiles and drones towards Israel. They broke some kind of a fine line that was there, like the deterioration line, that never passed. On attacking Israel directly, and now their appetite has grown. And then they're now declaring and talking about attacking Israel directly and in a more severe way. Why? Because Israel was able to first and foremost kill Ismail Haniyeh, who is the head of the snake of Hamas, the man that encouraged Hamas not to really negotiate with Israel. I mean, negotiate, but just draw time and not really reach a goal. The man that led all these so-called political, but there's no separation between political and functional and military in the Hamas organization, the terror organization, was traveling around the world trying to raise money to gain more support to attack Israel. He's been the guy who's gone back and forth to Turkey to incite Erdogan, to the extent that he's threatening Israel with an invasion right now. So Israel was able to reach him in his room. In Tehran, this was his lodging. Yes. Can you imagine? They give shelter to all these mega terrorists, and they took him out of the game. And on the same time, within the same 24 hours, Fuad Sukar, who was the chief of staff of the Hezbollah in Lebanon, was also eliminated. Israel took him out of the game as well. And this was the man who gave the order, literally gave the order to shoot the rocket, the heavy rocket that hit the Golan Heights and killed 12 children in a soccer field. Just their big scene was that they wanted to play just like any other kids. And Israel took him out of the game as well. And now the Hezbollah, together with the Houthis and together with the Iranian militias and together with Iran directly, has been for over a week intimidating, threatening Israel with a massive attack over Israel assets within the country, outside of the country, everywhere. Of course, America and the international community are trying to put that pressure over Israel,
always,
not to retaliate if they should hit us. And on the same time, though, we have to be honest, they're trying to put political pressure, diplomatic pressure over Iran and the Hezbollah and the state of Lebanon and its crippled government not to wage war against Israel and just to tame themselves. And maybe it's working, because we have seen that for over a week now, the Iranian promise to hit Israel hasn't come forth yet. But from intelligence sources that we have in the U.S. and within Israel, we know for sure that the new president of Iran, Masoud Fasakhshian, has been begging, literally begging. His calls were intercepted by the intelligence agencies, begging Ali Khamenei, the supreme leader of Iran, so it's called, not to hit Israel, not to target Israel, knowing with his wisdom, and you cannot say that the Iranians are not smart. This is a smart nation. They used to be a huge empire in this world.
Yeah, of course.
Knowing that Israel will not hold their horses back. And for sure, if they're going to hit Israel and cause severe damage in Israel, we will cripple the Iranian economy beyond return, and also their military. The targets there are the refineries and the oil wells and their and their ports and their airports and their bases and their nuclear facilities and you name it. And he knows that Israel can roll them back to the Flintstones era. So he knows that. And he's trying to convince Ali Khamenei not to stand to his promise to his followers that they're going to destroy Israel. On the other hand, the chief of staff of the revolution, I always hard for me to express this, revolutionary guards, they call them, of Iran, that he said Israel and America thinks that they have been held, they've been able to hold Iran back from reaching a nuclear weapon. Wait and see, which is a crazy promise. You know, this is like literally threatening us with a nuclear war.
Yeah.
We know for sure from Israeli sources and the intelligence and diplomatic sources that even Putin has been in touch. And Russia is the biggest ally of Iran right now. They depended on Iran because Iran sends them all their drones. Oil. They help them with technology and oil. Not oil, literally. Oil. Russia is a supplier of oil to the world. But technology and weapons and military help. I mean, now Russia has been so weak that they need these Iranians to help them with these new angles of the war against Ukraine. But in the end of the day, you know, Iran was asking Russia for Sukhoi 29 aircrafts and jet fighters and for anti-aircraft defense systems, the S-300s and so on and so on. So they have mutual military relationship. But we know for sure that even Putin understands the powers and the ability of Israel. That's why for years they didn't stop Israel from attacking in Syria anytime we needed to, even though they have a huge presence over there. Yeah. He was asking Iran to not retaliate in a badly manner against Israel, knowing that what's going to happen. And we cannot stop from and cease from thanking the U.S., even though we're not so fond of this current administration. To say the truth, Lloyd Austin, the chief of the American Defense Ministry, together with the Pentagon and others, they can see Israel literally as their biggest ally in the region.
Yeah.
And the American interests in the Middle East are to help Israel. And therefore, they have approached here with destroyers and carriers and a huge, massive American military presence here in Israel, in the area, in the Middle East. And I think that the Iranians and their allies are watching this and they understand that there's a massive amount of international powers that are here together should anything will go downhill from here, should anything will go south. And I think that this is a huge message nowadays to every American ally in this region, including the moderate Muslim countries, that America will stand with their allies. And this demonstration of power is super important in the Middle East, in a place where power talks. I mean, you know, a lot of the things that Israel has been doing throughout the years together with the U.S. in the name of being more humanitarian and helpful and, I don't know, liberal and lefties and this is immediately interpreted in Arabic, translated into total weakness. But actions is something they do understand. And that's where we are. I'm sorry I took a long time to explain the situation.
No, I'm so sorry.
But in Israel, a lot of people are in a very dire situation. People are sleeping literally right next to their bomb shelters for weeks. And Hezbollah has been talking. Nasrallah has been speaking. He said the fact that Israel is on the edge and on high alert like this and not knowing when and what and how we're going to start our attack, psychologically, we're winning the war because they are afraid. And there's fear in the hearts of the, of course, people has children, you know, and people want to protect their children. We know how cruel the enemy can be. We've seen how they killed 12 innocent children.
Exactly.
They don't really surgically choose their targets like Israel does. They don't try to not harm uninvolved people or civilians like the West is doing. So that's the situation here. And of course, people are on the edge, and most of the airlines have canceled their flights into Israel, which grows a lot of pressure once over again, even for those who want to get out of the country just for a little retreat, go to Greece, go to Cyprus, go somewhere for a while, just to ease the tension over the children, over their families, to breathe a little bit. It's almost impossible now to get out of the country. Because of that situation, there's less competition. So those who want to leave, the prices are high. People cannot return to Israel even though they want to. It's almost a siege that is around Israel at this moment. And there's a huge pressure and steaming pressure over the Israeli government to strike a preemptive attack. And that's another decision that the Israeli government has to take nowadays, just like they did in 1967 before the Six-Day War. Because, you know, Israeli preemptive attacks finishes wars in 6 days. Israel wars just like this surgically, not finishing a war even 10 months after. We have to think about that. But with the criticism of the world, the it's way the they look at us, the anti-Semitism, the hatred, the fact that the polls, the Washington Post just announced the polls that took place in the U.S., over 55% of Americans are against sending troops to help Israel. This has never happened before. Look what happens when the politics is so radical left, so radically liberal, so extreme. Yes. With the choice of who's going to be running for elections on the Democrat Party, the American public are almost in alignment for that. The Republicans a little bit more, but all the radical left are literally against even sending troops to help Israel in an existential war that we're facing now. So we know that our followers, our people, are definitely on the other side of the map. We are the contraweight to those people. We do stand with Israel. We do love Israel. We do pray for Israel. We are sowing our seeds into Israel, into the Israeli military, into the Israeli people, because we know that this is what God is literally looking at. And all these enemies that comes against Israel, they're not coming against Israel or America or the West. They're fighting against the will of God and the choice of God. And you've been teaching their doctrines for years about the 12 Imams and what the Islam is really after, and their jihads and things like that. And people should really read what you've been writing about this, and you can share with them, because people don't really see the true faces of the deceitful Islam that we're dealing with.
It's true. Dubs, everything you've said, I think, is so spot on. And it's so important for all of us to be informed, to know the truth, to know what's going on. That's why we do the show. That's what why we're continuing what we're doing, because it's so important. The mainstream media is so far left, most of it. They're not presenting the truth. They're presenting such an aggressive anti-Semitic bias against Israel. And so whenever you come here, you're going to get the truth. You're going to get it flat out exactly as it is. You're going to hear the will of God, and you're going to hear the voice of God, and you're going to hear exactly what it is that's happening with no filter. And so please don't stop praying for the peace of Jerusalem. Please keep praying. We have to trust God now more than ever for a miracle, and we know he's the same God, so he's able to perform miracles like he did in Bible times, and that's the thing that I keep holding on to.
He did it on April 14th, 13th, the same year. Nobody in the international community professionals could ever even imagine that they said, okay, maybe they'll be able to intercept 80, 85, 90% of what came against Israel, but 99.9%.
Impossible.
And that's this little gap between the science and the reality is God's miracles.
Exactly. And that's what it is. So thank you for joining us, Dubs. Thank you. Continue to pray for Dubi and his family and for all of our friends and partners out there in Israel. We thank you. God bless you. And next week, we'll see you again at Israel Update. God bless.
This week on Real Life, Real Faith, we are talking about the topic, Help, My Tongue is on Fire. We discuss this from every angle, looking at the book of James chapter 3. And there's definitely some interesting opinions, I think, from all of us about this. And I think we come to some pretty solid conclusions. So you don't want to miss out on this. Go to real-faith.tv to watch now.
I'm excited to announce my all-new mattress topper. In the times we're in, I wanted to bring you the best affordable mattress topper ever. So I took my two best technologies and combined them to make the ultimate mattress topper. And now you can get it for as low as $69.98. Queen size, only $99.98. It all starts with my famous MyPillow foam that provides you that overall full body support. Second is the individual comfort supports that give you an amazing custom sleep experience. It's like it's made specifically for you. The queen size alone has over 14,000 comfort supports. This is the perfect mattress topper to improve any bed. New bed, old bed, your guest beds. Get them for every bedroom in your house. Go to MyPillow.com or call the number on your screen. Use your promo code to get the all-new My Mattress Topper for as low as $69.98. Queen size, only $99.98. Don't delay. Order today.
We here at the House of Destiny are partnering with you to let our viewers, of course, know about your company. It's Beverly Hills Precious Metal.
Andrew, explain how that works.
So I'll walk you through it right now. So if you go to bh-pm.com, right there on the homepage, you'll see a form that you could fill out. And that form is very important in letting us know how we can help you. So you just put in your first name, last name, email address, phone number. There's a section that says, how did you hear about us? And in there, put Kim Clement. And then there's a portion where you could write a couple of notes down on the bottom. Usually within about 24 to 48 hours, we'll contact you by phone call. And then we'll go over everything with you. This isn't a high pressure deal. We always recommend that if you feel uncomfortable, take a step back, pray about it. You will gain the answers that you need by doing that, and come back to us when you're comfortable.